Hi, this is Gayle with Bernina of Naperville. And you know, sometimes a little whoopsie happens and we were having an advanced cross stitch class via Zoom. And wouldn't you know, everything just crashed in the middle and I owe those folks a video for how to make the queen here in cross stitch. So we're gonna do a couple little exercises first, but then you too can have a QE2. Let's see how to do this. So I'm going to be working in Designer Plus. I'm going to be working in Designer Plus because Designer Plus is the program that allows me to have the cross stitch maker and quilter. These are two additional applications. Creator is an option for you if you are just getting into digitizing and you want to create your own designs. But if you want these additional applications, you need to get Designer Plus. So we're going to open up our Designer Plus. And then once our Designer Plus opens, well, you're going to see what to do right now. I want to start with a new image. And before I do anything at all, as far as the cross stitch goes, I need to bring in the picture. And before we bring in Queen Elizabeth, I have a few things that I just want to show you, okay? So let's just work over here in a piece that, you know, I don't demonstrate very often. It's called the artwork canvas. And the artwork canvas, when you click on that icon, it opens Corel Draw right within your Bernina embroidery software. And this is a very advanced program. You can do all kinds of stuff with it, but I am using it mostly to adjust brightness and contrast on photos, to crop them, to change the size so they're not super gigantic, because, you know, sometimes if we take an image off our phone that we've taken a picture of, our phones these days take pretty high resolution images, and sometimes those images are just simply too big to serviceably use in our software. So I'm going to load a picture from this little icon right here. It is a flower with an arrow pointing at it. And I have an advanced cross stitch folder that I've created here. And in here, let's just view my large icon so we can see what we're opening. So we're going to start just simply with a daisy image. Now, this is something that I got from a free, royalty-free picture site, but this could be maybe a photo that you took. It could be a photo that you have in your family, you know, whatever it is. And I haven't placed this photo yet. What happens is when I bring this in, my cursor changes. It's got the information about the bitmap or the JPEG image here, and what I can do is just left-click and drag. Now, left clicking and dragging is making it whatever size I happen to put it in there. If you look up here at the little top area here, it's 7.5 by 4.9. And we aren't seeing our hoop here or whatever, but this is where you could resize the image here. And if you need it to be a little smaller, you can grab those little black handles around it and make it smaller. And then this indeed will help if when you're going into your cross stitch finally, and if you didn't prep this image, this could potentially be super giant when you do so. If for whatever reason this was super high res, you might be like zooming out for days in your cross stitch program. It'll make sense when we bring this in and I'll point that out to you. And also you have this proportion here, this little lock button. So most of the time I would recommend that you keep that locked. If, for instance, you had to make this design 5 inches wide, when I type 5 up there and hit enter, it's not only reduced the width, but it's reduced the height proportionately to how the image was initially brought into the program. Now, I've had some questions about, well, you know, what is a bitmap image versus a vector image, and our cross stitch software works a little bit better with it in this application where we're trying to take like a family portrait or a picture of the queen or whatever, we're working with a bitmap. But let's just take a moment to see the difference about vector versus bitmap. Okay, let's talk a little bit about a vector image versus a bitmap or JPEG or a rastered image. So first, when we are in Corel Draw, which is what we are when we're in our artwork canvas, if I want to type a G, and I'm gonna make this brush script, okay? When I take this G and I make it whatever size I want to make it, look how big. Look how big I'm making this, right? No matter how big or how small, the little edges of this file are beautiful, crisp, and clear. I could like make this so big it could go on the side of a bus. That's because we are working with a two-dimensional flat object where all the black is black and it's clear. It's the way the design is created. It's a vector image. And vector images are dot draw files. They can also be Windows Meta files or vector. Obviously, EPS files or .ai files are vectors. But now what I'm going to do is insert a JPEG that looks just like this G. So we're going to insert our artwork. And I have a G right here. And now I'm going to draw this G the same size as that G. And now do you see the difference? Do you see those little blurry edges? And if we look really close on this design, if I zoom in like 400% on this, look at the difference between the edges on these two things. Not only is this blurry, but the blurriness is because there's all different kinds of little dots that aren't just pure black. They're black, gray, lighter gray, medium gray, charcoal, and things like that. Now, there's a lot more to this than what I'm showing you, but the vector side, where we're creating images in Draw here, there we are making vectors. When we are bringing in artwork like that flower, the daisy that you just saw, we're bringing in a bitmap. And yes, we can do things to these bitmap designs right here in this part of the program, but if we want to do anything serious to it, we're going to have to open another program that can open within this one, and that is Corel Photo Paint. And that is where we would right-click and open Edit Bitmap. And then that opens the bitmap. Now, that looks crisper from this vantage point here, but that's simply because that's the size I made it. So it's going to look the best at the size that I drew that G. But if we zoom in, see, as we zoom in more on this, we see those pixelated edges there. So that is this is an image made up of little dots, whereas this is an image that's kind of interpreting the information differently. It's just your very quick elevator speech. And if we were to make this an instant embroidery design, for instance, like let's convert this to embroidery. I've selected this G and I converted. Now we're going to show all and see how crisp and smooth those edges are. Also, it interprets that vector. If we go back over here to our artwork canvas, and I'm going to do an undo. If we look at this here, there it breaks the image down by, you know, different segments. And when we're creating just a regular embroidery file from this, that conversion process sees that. I'm going to take my design and I'm going to say convert to vector. And now I have my little other design here that was the bitmap. So this was the vector, this is the bitmap. And now let's do some auto digitizing. I just want to do a magic wand to the black here. What I'm needing to do is I'm needing to take that bitmap image and process it so that it is exactly white and black. So I want to move this down here to two colors. There we go. And now I'm going to say okay. And now let's stitch that out and see the difference in how that G was created. It's very flat. It doesn't have any movement like this is, like nicely worked around all of those curves and everything. And that's just the difference in how these things are being interpreted. Let's just say we undid the prep work as well. So let's go to Magic Wand and do this prep work again. What if we didn't reduce the colors? See how this is interpreting this as white and gray and all of these colors. And if I just wanted to auto-digitize this, you know, maybe I want to omit the white, but I want to show you the difference here. We say, okay, I've got all kinds of weird little colors around this thing. And I really wouldn't want that. There's times when you might want this because, you know, you're trying to make something more photorealistic. But in this option, the bitmap doesn't work as well. But because in this Queen Elizabeth and in our Daisy, we're trying to create something that is a bit more realistic. We need a bitmap image that has all of those colors in it to give it life. We don't want 100 colors, but we want more than just black and white. All right, now that we know the differences, what we need to do now is our software here is really only going to allow us to draw basic shapes, add some lettering, erase things, do some different things like that. But what I really want to do is alter this photograph. I think there's a lot of extra space over here to the left side, and I think I might be able to do some other things with this. So with that said, I want to right-click on this image and edit my bitmap. And so here's my bitmap where I can crop it. That's what that symbol means. I can add some other things. I can alter the background a little bit. I could do just different stuff to it that, you know, I wouldn't be able to do in that program that opens up within our software. So the first thing I said is I wanted to crop this so I don't have all of this space over here on this side. So let's just say I'm going to make it like this size instead. And then I would say crop. And see how it chopped it out? It didn't make it larger or smaller. It just literally cropped it. Now I might have some other options here. Now, what I can do here is if I decide that I want to adjust this, make it brighter, make it more contrasty, I can go into adjust, and there is this drop-down image for the image adjustments lab. Now, I want you to know, we are just scraping the surface of this software, but this is just how I use it for certain applications like the cross stitch maker. But I also do this when I'm working with photo stitch and with photo snap. So just keep this in the back of your mind. So I have little sliders, and let's just be honest, we don't need to take up time to learn exactly what each of these sliders do. We can just kind of start moving things around, and you can see that the picture changes. And then we can also up the brightness, up the contrast. Maybe we don't need to make it so bright there. But look at how this becomes a very different photo than the one we started off with. I mean, it just gets kind of cooler as we do this, right? And what I'm trying to do is just get like a little isolated flower there. Okay, let's say that's what we like. We can say okay to that. And now maybe we need to kind of go in here and fix this. So let's just say we're going to paint. And I'm just going to take what I did with this. This is a clone brush. So this allows me to select this and I click somewhere that I like the color. And once I do that, then I was able to remove that red. And so now let's close. And yes, I do want to save the changes. And so look at that. So now I have something that might be kind of super cool to create into cross stitch or many other things. So now if we try to do a save as on this, it's going to want us to save this as an art file when we do save as. And this isn't quite our stitchy file. A .art is a design, embroidery design, but we don't have any embroidery designs in here, so this isn't appropriate. But there is a little floppy disk with a flower, and this is what allows us to save our artwork. So now I'm going to go in here, go back to my advanced cross stitch folder, and I'm going to call this bright flower. You can call it whatever you want. And now I'm going to make sure that I save that as a JPEG, because that's the one that has been tending to work the best for me for this process. And now when I export that, I can do it custom, I can do high quality, I can do original, but we can just do, I can even say we can do a low quality. And I don't think you're going to notice a big difference. And so once I have that, I'm going to go ahead and say okay, and that's going to make the changes for me. And now this is in our piece. I can do whatever I want. I can go over here now to my embroidery field, and there it is. We can do some fun stuff to it. But today's class is about cross stitch. So now that we have this isolated flower, we might want to do some cross stitching with it. So now let's open that drawer, and it's over on the left-hand side in our little toolbox drawers, and we go all the way to the bottom to applications and to cross stitch. Now, just because we're here in our cross stitch field and we had that picture in our Bernina Embroidery Designer Plus software, that picture's not going to be here until you go to this picture tab and insert it. And there's our bright flower, and we're going to say okay. And now we can go back to our design, and we can either use a magic wand to digitize certain elements of this flower, or we could do my favorite thing, which is auto stitch, click on it, and then we can come back here and see what's happening. But before we do anything more, we're going to close this and talk about the stitch count. And what I mean by stitch count is not quite the same as if we were talking about a regular embroidery design. What I'm really talking about is under settings and fabric count. So doing cross stitch, if any of you have ever done hand cross stitch before, you know that there's 8 a cloth that yields like 20 stitches per inch or 15 stitches per inch, 14, 12, whatever. This is where you may decide, well, how much resolution do I want on this design? Do I want a lot of stitches? Do I want my X's to be larger? You know, what's going on here? So I'm going to change this to 16 and okay. And you'll notice that the flower kind of got bigger in my hoop, or rather the grid got a little bit larger. So whatever you choose for your fabric setting or your fabric count is what you are going to need to choose before you make your image. And I need to take Bonaparte's squeak toy away from him right now. So once you make your choices, you're going to say okay, and then you see the design. Now, one of the things I want to do here is show you the difference, different ways we can select stuff if we want to get rid of crosses. So the first thing, back here, that little flower, that represents our picture. So I've removed the picture, and it's going to be easier for us. And then we have these little zoom boxes, and I can drag a little box around this to make my design bigger on the screen. So I have this selector, this regular blue selector, and it won't do anything if I just click on this design, but it will do something if I left click and drag a box around it. So left click and drag, then delete. It deletes whatever's in that box, but that's not ideal for me. This next one is called auto select, and I can select a color and it selects the whole color, and then I can delete it. And I'm going to do that with any of these little rogue colors that are over here, because I just want this isolated flower. And then I might go through here and just delete some little extra things here that I don't like. This is an example here, this little group of gray, where I can drag a box around it and delete it and just get rid of it quickly, but then of course change back to my design here. I don't want that bright green in there. I don't want that bright green in there. Where'd this one? All right, do I like that? I think I do. Okay, so indeed, if this is what I like, I'm gonna save this. Now, our cross stitch files are a little bit different than our Bernina embroidery design files. I'm gonna save as, and it's gonna save it as a .arx. The ARX file cannot be read on your sewing machine, but we can read it in our Bernina embroidery software over here. So now let me say file, open design. And it is warning me that it's a special kind of design. And there it is. And now I can really send this to the machine and stitch it out. But sometimes I like to have a little bit of a look at it just to make sure that all of the colors are coming out just the way I want them to. So looking at these colors, we can see here that we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. We have 9 colors, and that falls within our 10 color limitation. So with this, I can now assign this colors. Instead of just taking a shot in the dark here, I can actually assign it to colors that I might already have in my repertoire. So I'm going to go to design and thread colors. And you see here how it's saying 56 colors. Well, I don't really have 56 colors. Let's close this and then go over here, down here at the bottom, to discard unused thread colors. There we go. Now we just have the 9. And now I'm going to go back to design, thread colors, and now I have my Gayle thread chart right there. So I want to use my Gayle thread chart, and I want to match and assign all, starting with my very first color there. And now I'm going to say apply, and I want you to see the difference over here on the left. It's a little bit darker, but you know what? I had no expectations of what to stitch this flower in when I started. So I'm perfectly fine with this. Another thing that we want to look at here is it's going to take 14,185 stitches. That's not going to take me long at all to stitch out. Now, the hardest part now is figuring out what I want to stitch it on. So now that we like something, I'm going to go ahead and just save this. And I'm going to save this as, call it Bright Flower 2. And then I'm going to close it. And now, do you think we're ready for Queen Elizabeth? I'd like to be ready for her. Okay, so I'm going to go over to my artwork canvas. And all I want to do is just make this picture a wee bit smaller. I have a jumbo hoop with my 880, and I just want it to fit in the jumbo hoop. So let's load our photo, which is insert artwork. And I'm going to find her. I have her right here. There we go. And now I'm just going to click there. And now that just makes it the size that it's saved at already. And up here it says 8.767. That's going to be a little bit big for my jumbo hoop. So I think I'm going to just make it a little bit smaller. Let's do 7.5. Let's lock my proportions and change this to 7.5. Enter. And now I think that's going to look okay. We want to do it indeed. If you are resizing it, you want to save it. You don't forget you're going to do this save artwork. And we're going to find the folder that we want to save it into. And then I'm going to call this QE2 small. I've got a lot of versions of this. And now I'm going to say okay. Let's just bounce over to my designer side, my embroidery canvas, and see. Oh, yeah, she fits perfectly in there. Okay, I like it. It's a little bit smaller than my original version, but my original version was just a wee bit larger than the jumbo hoop. So let's go ahead and go over here and open our cross stitch program. And I want to show you another way that you can make sure Elizabeth is the right size. So we're going to right click on our hoop and we're going to choose the jumbo hoop with the number 26 foot. We're going to make sure we have our fabric count exactly how we want it. Now my original one was made with 20 stitches per inch. So we can go ahead and do that just so that you can see exactly the way I did it. And then I'm gonna zoom out so I can see my hoop. And now we're gonna insert that picture. And I have several Queen Elizabeths on here, but I'm gonna go ahead and open my original. Now, what I wanna do in our software, if you have something that's very, very close in size, you don't have to go back like I just did to resize it. You can just adjust the size to be a wee bit smaller. And I think you all will find that a little bit easier. But if it's super, super, super big, like if it comes in giant, then you want to resize it in the other program. And just for fun, let me delete this and show you what I'm talking about. See how big that cat is? Well, sometimes things are so big, it's hard to zoom out to even grab these little handles. So that's when you might want to resize. But let's go back and grab Queen Elizabeth. And there she is. Okay. So now we've picked our fabric count, we've got our hoop. We might want to resize her just a wee bit. There we go. And now we're ready. So let's hit our auto stitch and select. I want to do the current palette, but you know, I want more variety here. This, it's a Warhol, but it's a little bit avant-garde for me. So I'm going to try doing 17 different colors. That's let's see if there's other ways that we can do this. Now, my little flower stitched out pretty well using the current palette, but this is just one of those things where you have to play around a little bit. So I'm going to do maybe a specific thread chart, and let's try Isochord. That's looking okay. What do you think? Still looks like her. We can play around with how many color changes we might want. Now, one thing about doing this isochord is sometimes I find that it's not really 17 colors when I try to reduce it to 17 colors. So that's another thing that could throw a monkey wrench into this. So let's go ahead and see what we can live with here and say, okay. So there she is. She's looking lovely. And now if this is what we like, we can go ahead and save it. And now we're going to open this up. going to get rid of her here and go back to our embroidery canvas. And now I'm going to open. I called her Video Queen. There she is. She's got a lot of stitches, everybody. And let's have a look here. She has 98 thread colors. I know, it doesn't make sense that I picked that she has 17, but there's 98 here, but she's certainly lovely. And sometimes you can actually take some of these and kind of combine two colors together. Like I made color number 2 the same as color number 1, and that can start to help things a little bit. But sometimes we just have to go with that regular colors and then whittle them down from there and change them. And that combined together, and then some of these others could probably, let me turn off artistic view so we can actually see what we're picking. I think we could have 3, 4, and 5 all be the same color. So I'm going to change 3 to 5, color number 5. And then do the same to color number 4 and change that to 5. And then you'll see over here on this side, it's going to merge all of these colors together. And now this one, I'm tempted to also do it as 5. Now this process can take us forever. But when you're working on kind of some of these monster projects, this is just what needs to happen. So in this case here, this is another one that I think we can change to color number 1. And then I'm going to drag it up into this color film so it's right under the previous color. And now see how it's looking just a little bit better, perhaps. And now let's remove some unused colors. Okay, perfect. And now we got to start looking to see here is where we can combine some other designs, because there are just so many designs. And I just start from the top down. And so, and the nice thing about the cross stitch is that they're not layered on top of each other, so the pecking order doesn't really matter that much. Definitely want to make this one color number 2. Because see how there was some of that in there, and I want that to be kind of flat. So I'm going to combine that one up there as well. And I think, let's see what we're doing here. I think this one needs to be dark, but this one I think can also be color number, 2. Okay. Now this one, and this one, this one for sure, I want to be that teal color, but I think we might be good to make this one that teal color as well. I'm okay with that. This one can be that teal color. That one's fine being orange. This one I think is fine being orange. This can be orange. This can be 2. We're going to drag that up with her. Let's make that 15. Let's take this one and make that one 15 as well. And then we'll drag 15 up there with that one. going to make this one 3. And I might be making a mistake here. This is just like painting an art piece. Like, how many colors can we reduce this to and still kind of like the end product? And how, you know, different is it going to be? So I'm just going to work on this for a little bit and kind of whittle this down. And all I'm doing is just kind of changing colors and combining colors to different options. Okay, so once you get your Queen Elizabeth reduced, I have it reduced now to 11 colors, which is better than what we started off with. You could start going in and manually changing some things. So for instance, her eyes here, I want these colors, and I'm going to hold down Control to select her eye color. I want that to be dark. I want that to be 1. And then let's just zoom out and see if we like that. And indeed I do. So I'm gonna just bump those up together. I think that looks better. And now what we're gonna do is zoom in on her other eye and just grab a little bit, just a couple more, and make those dark, just to add a little bit more contrast. But remember, this is really, beauty is in the eye of the beholder here with this. And now, quite frankly, I want this color to not be plum. I want it to be more black or whatever. But once you've tweaked everything and you like it, now we're going to go up to, our design thread colors. And now this is where we can pull from the Gayle thread again. And what we want to do is go up here and just match and assign all. And if there's one that we wished was a little bit darker at this point, then we can find like a black thread from our isochord and say assign. And now let's apply. Okay. And so now that is Queen Elizabeth based on my thread colors and making some adjustments to the design. And now we're ready to stitch it out. And of course, it's going to stitch out great in this jumbo hoop, or is it? Let me talk a little bit about some issues that you might have with this. That's right, ladies and gentlemen. It's all fun and games until you get the error, please restart the machine. And that comes from that design that you just saw stitching out was 248,000 stitches. So there's a couple things that you can do in order to have a better stitch out experience. And the easiest thing, like if you have the jumbo hoop and all of that, all you need to do is pick like your first few colors. Let's just say we went to the first like 8 colors and we cut them. Control X. And then we created a new design and pasted. Then, and we save that as stitch out 1. Then you go back to your design and you take a few more different colors. That's another 5 stitches. Now we're going to cut, Control X, pick a new design, and paste, and zoom out. And we can see this is 109,000 stitches. I'm going to just eliminate number 6 there. Ooh, and number 5. There we go. So now we're at like 75,000. Now we're going to save this as stitch out 2. And then we're going to take these few. Let's see. So we ended up only using those 3. But what I'm doing here is I'm just kind of grabbing these files. Get a new one. This is going to be stitch out 3. Ooh, still a lot of files there. Let's take out 5. And now let's save this file. Save as. Stitch out 3. And now let's see, what do we have left? And then we'll do these last 3. Control X, new file. And this is gonna, yeah, this will work. And now we say file, save as, stitch out 4. And now what we've done is we've reduced that file size of each one so the machine doesn't have a coronary fit. You know, because it's just a lot. It's taxing that machine when you do these super large files like this. And the benefit is, if we take these files and we make sure that the design, and we make sure that the machine is going to start at the middle and end at the middle, it'll keep these designs centered. So we go and we just make sure that it's like that. Auto start at the middle, auto start at the middle. Thank you very much. And all of our designs, we want them to do that. And that way they come into the hoop. It's right at the center. And so everything's going to be placed very nicely. And we never really mess up your original design. You don't save this one. You're just cutting and pasting as 4 different designs. And just some more tips for a great stitch out is that you want to use a size 75 embroidery needle, because if in my case, my Queen Elizabeth was the 20 stitches per inch. So the stitches are really tiny. So we want a tiny needle, like a thin number 75 needle. I put fusible woven on the back of my fabric, as well as using a stabilizer. And I stabilized with a heavyweight cutaway. I turned off my thread away option just because it was slowing down the stitching time, but it will make your work look really hairy on the other side, but I think you won't mind that if the top side looks really pretty. So I just turned thread away off to eliminate the pauses between jump stitches. If you want to have thread away on, you're going to reduce the minimum cut to 2 millimeters. And if you have any whiskers, I like to trim them between color changes. And then speaking to that large file, you want to reduce that file by only stitching groups of colors in your design. Now, I know there are some of you out there asking this question. What do you do if you don't have a jumbo hoop and you want Queen Elizabeth to be like an 8x10? Well, the easiest way I found to do this requires a little prep of your photo, but I crop my actual photograph before I engage the cross stitching. And here's how to do it. We're gonna go and open a new design. And we're going to go over to our artwork canvas. And now we're going to insert the picture. And there it is. And we're going to see it to fit. So we know we're looking at the whole thing. Right click and edit bitmap. All right. So now what I want to do is take a line. And do you notice how here, if this little task, if this little icon has a little chip, a little arrow coming out, it gives me more choices. So just like we have a toolbox for our Bernina embroidery software, we have a toolbox in the Corel photo paint and a toolbox in the draw. But we want to go down here. So this is, this are our drawing tools right here, but we want to make a regular line. So we're going to right click and go to line. Perfect. Now I want to make sure that it is a skinny line. So I want it to be maybe 2 pixels wide. And that's what this is right here. Let's see here. The color is going to be light gray. I'm fine with that. Okay, so now I'm going to go like maybe at the 4-inch mark right here. And I'm going to draw. Maybe we'll put it down here because we don't really want, you might even consider, let's undo, drawing it over here offset, so that you wouldn't get like some, if you didn't hoop this properly, you wouldn't have like her nose displaced. I mean, we're doing a Warhol, not a Picasso, you know? There we go. And now we're going to do a little line going across like this. So now we're going to save this as Elizabeth with crop marks. So let's go ahead and close. Yes. And then you would save this if you can't work on everything today. We would go to, call it QE2 with crops. Let's do a PNG. Okay, so then these pieces are here so that we can cut it apart. So we're going to edit this one that has our lines again. So let's right click and go to edit bitmap. And we would use this crop image, and I would just crop this like that and say crop. But I don't want to save this yet. So in order for this to be a fun experience, we have to make, because we're going to have this quadrant, that quadrant, that quadrant, and that quadrant. So what we want to do is make a copy and paste. Paste another copy. And paste another copy. There's a method to my madness, I swear. So on this first one, we're going to right click and edit the bitmap. And we're going to crop it. Crop. Close and save. Yes. Okay, there's quadrant one. This one's going to be quadrant two. Right click, edit bitmap, crop. And now we're going to go down here. Get this part of her. And then if you feel like you need to tweak it, like you didn't grab enough stuff, you can adjust these little crop marks before you say crop and close and yes. And now look, there she is together. Now we're going to take this one, edit bitmap. crop.
And we're going to do this part. Crop. Close. Yes. Okay. If you have something and you feel like, I don't know if I cropped this just right or whatever, you can always undo and go back. Edit bitmap. Crop. Crop, close, yes. Okay, so there she is. So now what we're gonna do is we're gonna, you have to trust me with this one, everyone. Delete, delete, delete. And then with this one, we're going to save it as, let's just say, QE2_1 for quadrant one. I'm trying to remember, did I save these as a JPEG? Let's try JPEG. Yep. Okay. So then we're going to export and say, okay. Now we're going to undo. Undo, undo, and we're going to delete this one that we just did, her chin and her other side. And now we're going to save this one as a JPEG, and we're going to save this one as QE2, QE2_2 for quadrant two. Now we're gonna undo, 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 and we're gonna delete this one, and this one, and we're gonna save this one. And we're gonna call it QE2_3. And then finally, undo, we're gonna delete this one. We don't need it anymore, and this is our last one. And we're going to save this one as QE2_4. And now we're done with the Corel Draw and Corel Photo Paint option. So we can delete that, move on to our embroidery canvas. So now we're going to open up our cross stitch design maker. You've seen me do this too many times. And now we're going to say picture, insert, and we're going to go for that QE1. I'm going to go for this one. This is one I did earlier, but I numbered them a little bit better. Okay. So here's where you would take one of your quadrants. And then we can go ahead now and make it our cross stitch design. And we can do a specific thread chart and say, okay, or do current palette. You know, this is where we kind of have to work with the colors again. All right. And then we'd say file, save as, and whatever you want to name this. Okay. So now we're going to go ahead and close our cross stitch. And now we can see how these are going to look together in our software. So now we're going to insert a design. Okay, so there it is. It's 93,269 stitches. And I'm just going to put it aside for a second, but I do want to group it. So I'm going to say Control G on my keyboard, which groups it. That way it allows me to kind of move it around without taking a cross stitch away. Now I'm going to insert test two and I'm going to group it. And now I'm going to see how these two guys play together right there. And now insert test three.
And then once you have those four files, you could decide to stitch them in two hoopings or four hoopings or whatever the case is, depending on what the largest hoop is that you're starting with. And if you want some more advice or just more tips for stitching out cross stitch designs, there is a great article written by our friend Haley at wealso.com, and this demonstration uses the built-in K-facet cross-stitch designs, but the principles are great for any multi-hoop elements of a cross-stitch design. And you can see it right here at wealso. Very good step-by-step instructions.
All right, well, I hope you enjoyed this exercise. It was advanced, but I think you're up for the task. Now, don't forget that the Bernina Quilter application is found in Bernina Designer Plus version 9. It's also found in the version 8 software, but those of you that have Creator or are thinking of deciding between Creator or Designer Plus, the Designer Plus is the only one that's going to have this cross-stitch capability. So, now, if you want to see other videos and other tutorials that are related to sewing, embroidery, serging, long arm, and more, don't forget to check out the Bernina of Naperville YouTube channel. It's easy. It's youtube.com/Bernina of Naperville, and there you can like, comment, and subscribe. See ya! God, time to play.